Welcome to a brand new episode of Smile with Prachi. This is Prachi. Before we start with today's writers, I quickly want to refer back to a letter that we read in the last video, which was from a writer that we called Lamp. We called her Lamp. She had written about her younger sister who she suspected to be pregnant. So we discussed what she could possibly do, and she has written back to me. As it turns out that the sister is more than 6 months pregnant. So obviously she can't abort the baby anymore, and they had to tell the parents. The parents were extremely angry. There was a lot of fighting, they have also physically abused the younger sister. But the family slowly coming to terms with the fact that this has happened and it needs to be handled. So as of now, what the plan is that let her carry on with the pregnancy. Thankfully, because of the lockdown, nobody gets to know that she's pregnant. And once she has the child, the mother of these two sisters will claim that she has given birth to this baby, and that this baby is hers, and she will raise that baby as a sibling of the two sisters. That's the current arrangement, and the younger sister seems a lot more comforted now. She seems a lot better now. And yeah, she's at least safe. Now, starting with the first writer of the day, who we are gonna call Ocean. We'll call her Ocean. Now, Ocean is a child. She's been through a lot. So guys, when you write your comments for her, please be very mindful of what you're writing. I don't want to come out so strong, but if there is any hate comment that I see in the comment section for this child, I will have to block that user. You'll know in just a little bit why I feel so protective of Ocean once I'm done reading with her letter. So starting with Ocean's letter, she says, "Hey Prachidi, I'm a 15-year-old girl. When I was 5, I got raped by my father repeatedly for 5 years. He used to put various objects inside me. Sometimes cover my mouth and tie me up, and sometimes even make me bleed. I did not tell my parents because I was afraid. He used to blackmail me saying that he would get me as well as my parents killed. Obviously being a kid, I believed him. He died 3 years ago, but even today, every time I go off to sleep, I feel the same old pressure of him on top of me. All these flashbacks and nightmares are unbearable. My parents think I'm lying about my dead grandfather. I reach out to my friends and teachers, but even they couldn't understand me. Even my close ones think I'm saying this to get attention. It feels like the more I reach out to people, the more I get hurt. I was strong enough to get through all of this, but now no more. I get suicidal thoughts. Have even tried to harm myself a lot of times, as nothing else seemed to get me out of all this. I seriously don't know what to do. Please help." Ocean, if you were in front of me right now, I would have hugged you and said, "I am so proud of you for being so brave. I'm so proud of you. I'm so sorry to know that you have gone through this. And yes, I believe in you. I believe you, and I also believe in you. If at any time, ever in life, you feel that nobody's understanding your feelings, that you have no one with you, I know I'm just this woman on the internet, but I still want you to come back, watch this video, read the hundreds of comments in the comment section for you who will tell you that you can get better. That they don't think you're saying this for attention. There'll be comments after comments. I promise once this video gets released, there'll be so many comments of support for you. And all these are people who believe in you. I think you're extremely brave because you came out to your parents, you tried to get help from your friends, from your teachers. It's a very sorry state of affairs that nobody has believed in you yet. Unfortunately, this is very common. Let me just talk a little bit about psychology here. It will help you and the rest of my viewers, boys and girls, who have been raped as children. It is very common for children to not understand what is going on. It is very common that you grow up feeling dirty, disgusted, or even guilty about yourself. If you don't feel these things, good, but if you do, I just want you to know that these are very common things that are seen. To come to terms with what has happened can often take you years, even as an adult. This is all a natural way of your brain processing some kind of trauma. And for that, you need help, you deserve help, and all of you can get better. Ocean, you can also get better. You are very brave. Okay? So here are a few things I'll tell you. Number one, you've talked about suicidal thoughts. Please get a suicide hotline number saved on your phone. Maybe even get a couple of them. Number two, there's an organization that recently wrote to me on Instagram saying that they provide free counseling. I will put down their number and their link in the description box below. You and the rest of my viewers, if you want to reach out to them, you can. I have not personally tried their services, but they did write to me, so I'll just pass it on to you guys. You can check them out. And number three, if you have any friend, anybody who you think you can talk to in times like these, please keep their numbers also saved as your emergency contact. So anytime you get these suicidal thoughts, you can reach out to them. Quick thing about suicide hotline numbers, sometimes they can be very helpful, sometimes not so helpful. Let me be very honest. So in case you don't find them being very helpful, you also need to develop some coping mechanisms. Now, I will just touch the basics of it. For more, you will need to speak to a professional. But for instance, next time you want to cut yourself, okay? Because a lot of people usually, when they try to self-harm, to get over some kind of pain, to deal with pain, usually tend to cut themselves. What you can do is, don't keep knives and sharp objects around you, at least for now. And maybe you can keep a bunch of permanent markers lying around in your room. So next time you want to cut yourself, take a permanent marker and just, you know, slash yourself with the marker in whatever ways that you feel like. It will help you vent out your anger, and because it's a permanent marker, the marks will actually stay for a couple of days. So every time you see the marks, you know that this is what you would have done. It will give your brain a lot of time to understand what you might have actually done, to reflect on your possible actions. It's a very helpful way of protecting yourself from doing something like that. Also, try to learn some breathing techniques. Something as simple and as cliched as counting till 10 or counting till 20 can really help you. You can tell yourself, okay, not today. I am getting this urge. Maybe I'll think about it tomorrow. I can allow myself to live for one more day. This will give your brain plenty of time to calm down. And in that one day, you can go find some help. Right? So this is something that you absolutely need to start practicing for your suicidal thoughts. But this is not the end goal. This is not going to solve your problem. This is just a very, very temporary suggestion. You need to speak to a therapist. I'm sorry, Ocean, if my answer disappoints you, but what you have gone through is serious, okay? And this is not something we can solve by 5 tips to get over sexual abuse trauma. That is not how this works. This has been years of trauma, years of things locked up in your mind. You need to really talk to someone. And you deserve it. You deserve to be heard. Okay? You need to do that face to face with a professional who will understand you. So how are you going to go for therapy? I don't think your parents will allow you to go for therapy immediately or pay for therapy. But first thing you need to do, find a therapist online. You seem very smart, so you can probably tell how to find a therapist. Well, I'll just give you an idea. Suppose you live in Hyderabad, suppose, okay? So what you do is go on Google and write, just search for therapists in Hyderabad. A lot of search results will come out. When you get all of these search results, go to these doctor profiles, find a doctor who is experienced. You need an experienced doctor, okay? This is not applicable for everyone, but in this case, definitely somebody with a lot of experience. Ask yourself if you're more comfortable talking to a woman or a man, if that is a concern for you, okay? And also, when you go through the doctor's profile, find a doctor who specifically deals with sexual abuse, child abuse, okay? Not a doctor who specializes in, say, marital counseling or relationship counseling or divorce and things like that. But someone who deals with child abuse, sexual abuse, that is their area of expertise and they have a lot of experience. You now know who your therapist will be. Okay, now how do you convince your parents? Well, there are a lot of steps involved. Let me just give you some ideas. Figure out what will work best for you. Your parents already, the good thing is your parents already know that you have been through this. They are just in denial. Why are they in denial, by the way? Let me break it down for you. They are in denial because they're not as brave as you are. Okay? It's easier to deny things that are hard. And that's what your parents are doing. I want you to know that. And you don't have to forgive them for this if you don't feel ready for it. It's absolutely fine. Now, what you need to do is go to your mom and say, "Mom, I need to see a gynecologist because I'm experiencing a lot of pain down there, a lot of heavy bleeding down there, even though it's not my periods." Tell that to your mom. Your mom will book an appointment with a gynecologist. If you can get her number, the gynecologist's number, that's very good. Otherwise, you can keep a little note in your pocket, in your shirt pocket, not in your pant pocket, in your shirt pocket. What does this message or this note, whichever way you go, this note or this message, what does it say? In that note or that message, you will tell the gynecologist that I need to speak to you privately. Please ask my mom to leave the room. Okay? And in brackets, just write, "No, I'm not pregnant." Mention that, because a lot of gynecologists, I'm sorry to use this word, but they can be a little insensitive about these issues. So just tell her, "I'm not pregnant, but this is something personal which I want to talk to you about. So please ask my mom to leave the room." Okay? So suppose you can message the gynecologist this, or if you can't, you have the note in your pocket. So when the gynecologist takes you for examination and you're lying on the bed and the curtain is drawn, you can just hand over the note to the doctor. All right? Now, when your mother has left the gynecologist's room, you tell the doctor, hear me out very carefully. You need to say it like this, okay? Tell the doctor that, "Doctor, I don't want to put you in a difficult position at all. I don't want you to get involved. I have been raped as a child and I am seeking psychiatric help. My parents know about this, but they are not willing to sign me up for therapy because they think I am lying. The reason why I'm here is because I want you to talk to my mom privately. Once she comes back to the room, I want you to talk to my mom privately and just tell her this, just tell my mom this, that you have examined me, you think that this is psychological and that I need to see a psychiatrist, because if I don't, I may not be able to get married or have children in future. You do not have to talk to my mom about rape or anything. You do not have to mention this conversation. Just tell her you think it's psychological, which is true because it is psychological. If you know any good psychiatrist, you can give their phone number. Otherwise, you can recommend this. Or you don't have to recommend anyone at all. Even that is fine. But just tell my mom that I need psychiatrist. And if I don't, I may not be able to get married or have children in future. And that there is something very serious. Please tell my mom that. It will help me. I do not want you to get involved otherwise. Just do that. Okay? Tell the gynecologist to talk to your mom about this. There's a good chance that your mom will have this conversation with the gynecologist and nobody will take you to a psychiatrist or a therapist. That's okay. After a few days, go and tell your mom that you need to see another gynecologist because things are not helping. Repeat the process. Repeat the process for 4-5 times till your mom is constantly hearing this from everyone. So what has happened is now your mom is getting this recommendation from educated adults, from the medical field. There are three possibilities. First possibility is that your parents actually get convinced and immediately take you to a psychiatrist or a therapist. Okay. If they are planning to take, you can say that, "Okay, this is a doctor who I would want to see. I have taken their number and whatever." Nothing like it. That helps solve your problem. You have signed up for therapy and of course you can take it from there. However, there's also a possibility that your parents continue to ignore their warnings and their suggestions. It's also possible that one of these gynecologists blurts out to your parents that you're trying to do all this. They rattle you out. If two or three happens and your problem does not get solved, you're not taken to a therapist or a psychiatrist, now it's time for the last and final resort. What you're going to do is tell your parents that you will stop studying, okay? You will write a Facebook post telling everyone that this is what has happened to you and your parents are not helping, okay? You tell your parents that you will tell all their friends, all the relatives, all the family members, whoever you meet, you will tell everyone that this is what has happened to you and you're not getting help. You also tell your parents that you're suicidal and that if this continues, there's a good chance that one day they'll wake up and find you dead in your bedroom and then they will have to deal with the police. You will write a suicide note if you die. And you will also have your Facebook post and then your parents will be taken to jail. This is the last resort. It is literally declaring war against your parents, but you will have to do this because your parents are not willing to help you. There's a good chance that there'll be a lot of fights and, you know, a lot of things being said, and, you know, they'll try to make you feel guilty, make you feel like a bad daughter. Don't fall for it. Okay? Be very brave. You have to be strong and you have to do this for yourself. If your parents say, no, you're a liar, then say, okay, fine. If I'm a liar, take me to a psychiatrist to tell me that I should stop lying. Maybe they'll teach me to be a better person and not lie. But take me to a psychiatrist. I need to go. Put your foot down and do not take no for an answer, no matter what it comes down to. Okay? They may take away your phone, they may take away your access to the internet, but you've also given them suicide threats. Right? Do that. Now, another thing that you need to do, apart from all of this, if you are very spiritually inclined, you can join some kind of a course, for example, Art of Living. You can join a yoga course, meditation course. It will help you calm down. And for the rest, your psychiatrist, your therapist, they will help you figure it out. A psychiatrist is someone who gives you medicines, okay? A therapist, who you will be seeing more often, is someone who will help you learn how to manage your thoughts in a scientific way. But the good news is that you can get better, Ocean, and I'm rooting for you. Okay, you are very brave and I really think you can get better. For the rest of my viewers who are watching this video right now, please extend your support to her. If you have been through something similar, please share your stories. Not only will that help you heal, it will also help the writer. Okay? Moving to the next writer of the day, who we are going to call C. I think I've given these names before, Ocean and C. Anyways, C. C says, hi Prachi. I'm 21 years old in relationship for last 6 years. We told our parents about us so we can get married. Our families have known each other for 2 decades, so as you can guess, everyone agreed happily. However, since the families got involved, I'm seeing a change in his behavior. His mother doesn't let him talk on the phone with me that much. She thinks I'm distracting him from his studies. What's strange is that we used to talk the same way before. How come this never bothered his mom much, but now it suddenly is impacting his studies? When I talk to his mom, she also has started treating me differently, telling me what all I need to learn, things I should improve on, etc., etc., like how I dress her, pictures on my Instagram. She never commented on these things before. The thing that struck out the most was when his dad told me that I won't be allowed to pursue my career, but I've always been a very, very career-oriented Prachi. Sorry, I read that wrong. But I've always been very, very career-oriented, Prachi. My boyfriend understands that this is all sudden, but he doesn't want to hurt his parents. He is worried that if he fights for me, his parents won't agree for the marriage. Once he also casually mentioned that after all, there is a difference between friend and daughter-in-law, and that in our society, women are expected to change after getting married. So I should see things from his parents' point also. Our parents are meeting soon after the lockdown to finalize the ceremony dates, but quite honestly, I'm freaking out a bit. Please suggest a way forward. Considering how supportive your parents have been, do you think you can probably confide in your mom and dad and tell them that you have these concerns? In your case, see, your parents and his parents are family friends. They have known each other for 2 decades. So maybe if you sit down and talk to your mom and dad, they'll be able to point out what the problem might be. They know them as friends. They know them very personally. It's a good idea to express your concerns. So that way your parents can delay this a little bit. That way your parents can also help you understand how to handle the situation better because they already know the family so well. One thing I really want to point out for you, C, and for the rest of my viewers also, that there is a huge difference in giving up your freedom and compromising. In changing who you are as a person entirely or taking one for the team. Marriage, I can totally understand what your boyfriend is saying here, because in a patriarchal society, in a country like India, this is something which even I have heard a lot. Girls change after marriage. I've been married for almost 5 years now. There are times when I visit Kolkata back at my native place, and when I stumble upon the people from, you know, my life before marriage, aunties, uncles, a lot of them, they will come to me and say in a very accusing way, You don't seem to have changed even a little bit after marriage. You still look the same, you still dress the same. And I can see that judgment in their tone. I ignore them. But there's something which for some reason the society expects to happen. A woman to change entirely overnight. That's not how human beings are designed. Your personality remains the same, you still remain the same person. Marriage is, yes, a very important step in your life, but that doesn't mean that you flip and switch completely in one day. You grow with time, you mature. For instance, me and my husband, we used to be very messy before marriage. We still are very messy. But now that we are sharing a room, we are sharing a life, we are sharing a house together, we try to be a little less messy. Because it's inconvenient for the other person. That's growing up, that's maturity. But to give up your freedom, that doesn't make sense. They're asking you to give up your choice of clothing. They are asking you to give up on your career. These are not small compromises to make, and you should not agree for these things. I think it's a very big red flag that your boyfriend says that you need to understand the parents' point of view. That your boyfriend is afraid to take a stand for you in front of his parents. That he's afraid of the parents' reactions. I think you need to have a very strong heart conversation with him. I know you've been in a relationship for 6 years, but it's very important right now, given the situation that you're in. You need to call up your boyfriend and tell him that, see, this is non-negotiable. I need to have a career. Be very clear, be very blunt. And note his reactions. See how far is he willing to go to stand up for you. You know, you can't single-handedly change his parents and him and the entire family. That will not happen. You will need the support of your husband. So I would want you to definitely tell your parents to put this thing on pause, to not rush things. You're just 21 anyways. Also ask your parents what they think about their thought processes and if this could become a problem in future. I want you to talk to your boyfriend and deal with all of this in a very practical way. Not with guilt, you have nothing to feel guilty about. Somebody tries to make you feel selfish, no, you're not being selfish. And definitely don't think with your emotions right now. It's a very, very important part of your life. Getting married is a very crucial step. One wrong step can cost you a lot. Okay, I think your concerns are very clear, very valid. But you have to figure out a way. If not, call it off. So guys, that's all I wanted to share in today's video. We had some very, very serious letters today, some very serious talk. Like I said, please feel free to extend your support to the writers. You guys always do that. This time, I will persuade you a little extra because I think it's needed. They need it. They need to know. If nothing else, just write in the comment section that you believe in them, that you think they can get better, you don't think they are lying. Okay? And on that note, guys, thank you so much. Have a great weekend, everybody. Take care of yourselves. Be safe. And yeah, I'll see you guys again next week. Thanks for watching and bye-bye.